Turn up the radio and sing along. It's time for another great song. This is the Great Song Podcast.
Season's greetings and welcome once again to the Great Song Podcast. I'm Rob Alley.
I am JP Mosher.
And we're here to celebrate the greatest songs in modern music history. We're going to tell you what makes them great, why we think they're awesome, and why you should too. JP, how you doing today?
Man, I'm doing fantastic. I was just telling Rob off the air about this groundhog that's been in our backyard for an eternity. It seems like my wife took this awesome picture. I was like, Rob, check out this groundhog.
It literally looks like...
He's posing for the picture.
It's a glamour shot for this groundhog.
It's standing up. It's wonderful. Next time all you listeners are over at my house, I'll show you guys. Then it got us on a couple of different rabbit trails, one of which is like how to get rid of it. Well, I called the Humane Society and they're like, we can get rid of it, but it's $500 to set traps. And they're like, and our conversion, our catch ratio is about 80%. I'm like, so I'd pay $500 for on a maybe, pretty good maybe. I was like, what if I catch it? And he's like, oh, we can get rid of it for you. I was like, fantastic. How much does that cost? He's like, $500. I was like, it's the same cause.
Come on. Well,
so anyway. And then we were talking about Groundhog Day, one of the all-time greatest movies.
Yeah.
Ned Ryerson.
So
Needle Nose Ned with Bill Murray. So I'm going to throw a question at you, Rob. What song would play on your in your head every morning and wake you up on repeat that you would just be sick of, that you couldn't get rid of? In the movie, it's I Got You, Babe, from Sonny and Cher.
Yep.
What would be your song that would be just annoyingly or good, in a good way, wake you up?
I think mine would have to be because it was this in high school for like years. I woke up every morning to this song. This is Catapult by Counting Crows. The opening track to Recovering the Satellites. This was, I had it in my CD player and this was my alarm.
Which is not the song we're covering today, everyone.
No,
get ready for
But it was a weird way to wake up. This was me every morning. This song.
Man. That's a good way to wake up.
Yeah,
brings you into the day.
Nice and pleasant. It's a little weird if you let it get to the verse, because then it just feels a little awkward, disturbing.
I'll play mine, which would be good to start, and it's good, but every day, play "Good Day Sunshine" by the Beatles.
Oh, that's great. That's so pleasant. That's good. Absolutely.
Oh, let's wake up, everyone.
That's so good.
There you go. But if it wasn't going to be one of those two, we would probably both have to agree on Counting Blue Cars.
Dude.
Would bring you out the gates blazing.
Boom. Feet like, to the floor immediately.
I'd wake up punching the air.
Yeah.
Like, ready to rock. So the song we're covering today is...
Counting Blue Cars by Dishwalla.
And we have a treat for you guys.
Oh, my gosh.
It was a treat for us.
Dude.
So we're going to pass it along to you guys.
Honestly... Okay, so today we've got an interview with Dishwalla lead singer and writer of this song, J.R. Richards. And we geeked so hard, I honestly am afraid we freaked him out a little bit.
Yeah, he's probably like, you guys need to tone it down a bit.
Yeah, I think we went too hard. You know what I'm saying? I almost feel like we gave him a little bit deer in the headlights because we came so geeked out to this interview.
Yeah, we were the fans that met the celebrity in town. Are like, can we get a picture? Can we get you to sign my chest? What you think of this? Yeah. We were those people.
Yeah, exactly. But come on. This
freaking
song.
J.R. Richards. This song's great.
This song is the absolute peak of 90s like alt rock. You know what I mean? This is
it. And you have to realize this is 96, so me and Rob are freshmen. So this is a vulnerable stage for us.
Heck yeah.
We needed this song.
We did.
this song got us through those awkward years.
Oh, man.
I'm like, man, she's so cute, and I've got this pimple. Let's play Counting Blue Cars.
Okay, so before we start gushing over the song and before we trip all over ourselves trying to talk to J.R. Richards, let's play some of the song, and then we're just going to tell you what we love about it and get straight into the interview. Here we go. This is Counting Blue Cars by Dishwalla.
Yeah! Must have been mid-afternoon.
This song's perfect.
I could tell by how far
drum fill.
Oh, yes.
Dude.
So, you know it's a good song when... Okay, everybody air band songs. Let's just be honest.
Yeah.
So, when it comes to the chorus... I went cymbals high, crash, just crazy, and Rob went driving guitar.
Yeah.
So that means there's good parts all through this song.
That's right.
It's
different,
not the one thing.
Yeah.
There's so many things.
Different elements grabbing
us. Of greatness.
Through this whole song. This song is a, first of all, like, this song works on an acoustic. You know what
yeah,
I'm saying?
And
this
he
is
has
a,
an acoustic.
This is a good, interesting song.
Uh-huh.
Well done, has something to say, and so in that, it is a great song to begin with. But then you add on top of it the energy and the perfection of the production on this song. It's just incredible. I don't know. Honestly, I'm not 100% sure who's some of these choices were made, if they're band choices or production choices. Some, you know, you just don't know some of those things. But whoever kind of manicured this song into what it is, I applaud them greatly.
Well done.
It was just like... here's okay. This like introduction to this interview is basically just going to be us going, man, I love this and I love this,
this
and I love
great.
This. So whatever. I don't care. I freaking love
all
this
the
song
things
so much.
That we tear apart in other songs that we're like, we're not crazy about this. There'll be none of that in this episode.
No, there's nothing about this song that I don't like. There's nothing about this song that I would change. There is something, however, that we just noticed.
And we have played this song. We have covered this song in our wedding cover band.
Yeah.
Like we've played this multiple times.
I mean, I've heard this song hundreds of times, but just listening, we always try to listen to the song that we're covering to kind of get ourselves in the mood for it right before we go on air. And so we were listening to this one and I noticed, maybe it's because the headphones I'm using today, I've never noticed before, that the bass movement on the verses, when it goes, so we're in the key of D major. If you were to look at this, the chorus is in D major. Verses are kind of a B minor. Okay. And so it's that B minor, A, G classic progression, right? And when it goes back from the G to the B minor chord, the bass moves back 1/8 note late. So the bass is driving with eighth notes, boom, 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 right? Great drive. And then it gets back to that B minor chord, and instead of going bum, 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 it goes bum, 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 and comes up one beat late.
Listen, it'll make sense when you hear it.
So listen back to this first verse again, and just listen to the change. I'll cue you.
By how far?
Right here. Two, three. You hear it shift late? Let's get one more time.
He air cued with his hand.
Yeah, one, two, three, four. Boom, 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 boom. So crazy. I've never noticed that. And I love it. I totally love it. It's so, like, nobody does that. I've never really noticed that before. It's kind of a weird thing because...
If it would have just happened on the first hit, we'd think, oh, maybe it was an accident.
Exactly.
Maybe he missed it. So we're like, listen to the second and see, and then it does
but
it all.
But it's consistent,
it's
yeah.
In there,
So I've never noticed that before, and it's kind of weird because you end up playing chords over that don't necessarily fit for 1/8 note. But obviously, it doesn't do anything negative to the song, and it's just a cool little Easter egg that I've... literally never noticed as many gazillion times as I've listened to the song. So that's awesome. And we literally just found that.
New bit of awesome.
Man, 20 years later,
right?
This song is still blessing us with goodies. This hit number one on the Billboard Alternative Chart, number two on the Billboard Rock Chart, and number four on the Billboard Hot 100. Huge song. This is one of those, we talk sometimes about like, songs that you can't escape in you know, like on the bus, right?
Mm-hmm.
When you there's good songs and bad songs that you can't escape, songs that you would give your kidney to be able to change, right? And then there's songs that like you're so glad that this is the song that's playing on the bus while I can't change the
you're
channel.
Like, thank goodness no more Celine Dion, My Heart Will Go On.
Exactly.
It's Counting Blue Cars.
Yes, exactly.
Probably not on similar stations, I guess.
Yeah, sure. That could have been. Let me just give you some thoughts, and then we're going to get into this interview with JR because we want to give it its proper time. This song fires me up from the very first note. Like we talked about, as a wake-up song, it would be startling, but then you would be up, you know? Like Steve Miller said, we did Steve Miller last episode, and Steve Miller said in an interview that you have 4 seconds to grab the listener if you want your song to be a hit. This grabs me in 0.5.
Negative seconds.
Yeah, like it's that first drum fill and guitar thing is just like instant – energy in my veins, just, you know, whatever. I also have a question about, okay, so the first B chord and almost all the B chords on this, and in tons of songs that are guitar songs, what is it about playing a B chord on guitar that makes it okay to let the high E string ring out on a guitar? You know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're talking about.
It happens all the time. If it's B minor, if it's B major, there's just something about it that I don't know if it's because, I don't know if it started as laziness, right? And it's hard to cover up that note if you're playing a B chord.
Have to kind of palm mute it.
Yeah, it gives you something open to let ring out. You don't have to make a bar chord. Uh-huh. It really doesn't belong in the chord, but it happens all the time in songs that are either even in the key of B or, you know, are in E and you're hitting a B major chord and you just, for whatever reason, it's okay. You know, nobody's adding that note in other chords, right? You're not going to hit a big as life D chord and suspend it with a G on top. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
You're not going to just do that as the chord and not unsuspend it. But it happens on B chords all the time. And so this song does it big as day from the very first note. And it's cool as heck. And I don't know why that's a thing, but it totally is. But this, it's in that, it's... It does that a lot on this song, and it's totally fine. I don't know why.
Talking about coming out the gates blazing. You know, they teach you when you go into the gym, you're supposed to stretch and warm up. This is like the guy that walks in, and he's like, I'm going to jump from the free throw line and dunk it without even doing a bend over stretch.
Yeah.
Nothing. It's just right up in your face.
It's true. Something else I've never really noticed about this song before, because I always pay attention to the guitars, bass, and drums, and I knew there was a synth part. You hear it in there, and it kind of... gets more and less aggressive, you know, at various points of the song. But there's a synth line that plays something dissonant over the opening riff, and pretty often thereafter, I don't know if listening on my studio monitors at home kind of revealed something that I'd never noticed. It's probably covered by like the rumble of tires most of the time that I hear when I'm listening to the song. You know what I mean? But if you listen closely, it's just a single line, and it creates over the A chord. It actually creates a dissonant note. I think it's playing a G over the A chord, if I'm not mistaken. If memory serves me correctly. But if you go back and take a listen closely, I'm not going to, you know, dig into that just right this second, but take a listen to the synth part and just notice that it creates some dissonance. Also doesn't hurt anything. It's funny. There's several things in this song that are kind of, I don't want to call them rule breakers, but they're rule benders. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And none of them hurt the song. Why would you move the bass late, right? The bass is the foundation of your tonal center. Why would you make something dissonant with the synth part over your main chords? And why would you let a note that doesn't belong ring out on the, you know what I'm saying? But it all works. Like, it all, I don't know. It's just, this song is just...
Right place, right time, right notes.
And yeah, everything is perfect. I would not change one single thing about this.
Well done by this band.
Absolutely.
We'll talk a quick bit on Dishwalla. We'll play the jingle.
Yeah.
I won't go too in depth like I normally do, but let's play the jingle. Let's hear it.
Hey, let's meet the band. It's time to meet the band. Hey, mama, let's meet the band. Let's all meet the
All right, I'm just going to rapid fire the members of the band. I'm not going to get in depth like I normally do on each one. For those of y'all that are just joining us because you're Dishwalla fans or wanted to hear the interview with JR, this is completely different than the way we normally do our Meet the Band section. I normally go individual by individual, talk about what they contributed, their gear, and different back projects they played on. But I'm just going to list their names just so they can get their due credence so we can get quickly into the interview. On lead vocals, keyboards, piano, organ, Hammond organ, all the way through, a little guitar, J.R. Richards, who we'll interview later. On guitar and backing vocals, Rodney Browning. On bass, backing vocals, and he plays a little bells, and Roland Juno 60 as well on here is Scott Alexander. And George Pendergrass on drums, percussion, and backing vocals as well. So that's the band of Dishwalla from the Pet Your Friends album. Yeah. We didn't talk much about the album, but y'all will probably recognize this cover. Yeah. It's a awesome cover of a lady walking a deer.
Yeah.
It's from a magazine from 1948. It's the Time Life cover from the 1948 Time Life cover.
Really?
August 23rd. Yep.
I did not know that.
Lady walking the deer from Pet Your Friends. Neat album. This will be the hit from it.
Yeah.
So if you're looking for other hits off the album, you probably won't recognize anything, but there's other good nuggets of goodness mixed in there on that album.
Absolutely. So. And Dishwalla is still going.
Different lineup.
Yeah, different lineup, several lineup changes. And the one that you may or may not notice, as JR mentions, is that Justin Fox is the lead vocalist now. JR is no longer part of Dishwalla, but they after a hiatus, continued on without JR, and now Justin Fox is lead vocalist. But you'll hear JR talk a little bit about that, and everything's cool, man. Everything's copacetic. I just want to say a couple other things, okay?
Yeah.
I love the harmony on the chorus of the song. Let's hit it one more time. Yeah. You're going to hear three parts. It doesn't necessarily sound like a standard. It doesn't sound like quote unquote three part harmony, but that's exactly what it is. He's singing the melody, and then you've got two harmony parts underneath it. But what I love is the chords are such. So we're in the key of D major for the chorus. The second chord is an E major, which doesn't fall naturally. Naturally, it would be an E minor.
The two
chord.
Is normally minor.
Yeah.
In.
But it's not uncommon to hear this. It doesn't happen in alt rock very often.
Doesn't
anyway.
Change what Scott Alexander, the bass player, plays.
Yeah.
Just your main
exactly.
your guitar player.
Your guitar player
your
is playing a major
player.
Chord. Yeah. So you've got the main melody, tell me all your thoughts on God. And then you've got a harmony part that's literally staying on the same note, tell me all your thoughts on God. And then you've got a second harmony part that's going, tell me all your thoughts on God. And just a little chromatic movement. And so brought together, they create something that's really fun and does a great job of really outlining that unusual chord. That low harmony that moves down plays what becomes the major third of the new chord. I mean, sings what becomes the major third of the new chord and really accents that. Let me play you this second chorus here and you can hear it really well.
Often do, we said, tell me all your thoughts on God.
So you hear that, you got one right up here, staying there, and then da 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 da. Tell me all your thoughts on God. It's a little chromatic.
Cause I'm on my way to see her.
And then the one that stays. So tell me, am I very far? Yeah. So I love it. Just great. And man, I mean, we've talked about kind of the way the band feels on this, but his vocal is perfect for this.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's got everything that you want.
It's edge, it's intense, but it's not, it doesn't lose anything in
yeah,
its upper
it's,
register
and,
like
and
the
it's,
high parts.
And it's edgy and it's also like sort of tender.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, and this song, and he's going to talk about kind of the idea behind the song and what it's about. And it's got, you know, a lot of elements of like childlikeness and whatever. And so I just feel like his voice really conveys that super well. But it's strong. It doesn't feel out of place. It's just great. It's perfect for this. Like, this song is a perfect storm. Everything about this song is right. And whoever made all these decisions is just perfect. The drum fill after the first chorus is everything. It's one of my favorite drum fills in my life. It's got that good dynamic thing. It's syncopated. And then it goes, ga-ga-ga-ga, boom, like that snare leading into the second verse. I just love it so much. The guitar leads in the second verse and on the sort of guitar solo section are 1,000% perfect. The tone, the note choices, and that feedback on the second verse.
Yeah,
listen to this feedback in the second verse. It is glorious.
On our way, the sun broke free of the clouds.
Yeah, come on.
And then it fades out.
Dude.
Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, yeah.
That is just, seriously, that's glorious. Always been a sucker also for that bending a note between the 9 and the flat 3 over minor chord. Always a sucker for that. If you want to get me, just do that. I just love it. The I love that the chorus is not fully revealed until the second time through.
Uh-huh. Right? Yeah, it's a shortened chorus.
Yeah, the first time through. And that's often a production choice. You know, it's shorten it a little bit for radio. But in this case, it doesn't actually shorten the chorus. It just gives some extra information the second time
around. Oh, there's just more words. That's right. I didn't even think of that. It feels like a shortened chorus because it's got less words.
Yeah, but it's not. It's the same amount of time. So I think that's a, you know, that's a great choice there because it keeps interest in the song and adds this second element, you know,
like,
what I mean?
Whoa, her.
And yes, also, I was going to say, also adds the controversial line about ask her why we're who we are. So get ready to get your theology rocked by J.R. Richards coming up in a second.
The Reverend J.R. Richards,
that's right,
will be speaking.
The right Reverend J.R. Richards. So again, everything about it is great. The third verse, when the drums go down to kind of a brushes on the snare, you know, and it's getting cold. It just comes down. Ugh, I just love it. I got to stop. I'm doing the same thing to all the listeners that we did to JR, which is overwhelm you with our
this is why you're awesome.
Freaking out for this song. Okay?
Let's get in it. Let's hear him.
Let's just do it, you guys. I'm sorry. I got so much more I want to say, but I'll just save it. And when we do a, we'll do a live show somewhere and we'll recover this song.
That's right.
A 3-hour show on, on Counting Blue Cars. But before we get into it, make sure you hit us up on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and let us know what you thought about this episode. Let us know what you thought about the interview and all those things. Facebook.com/groups/greatsongpod or just search Great Songs and the Great People Who Love Them Greatly. Hit us up on Twitter and Instagram at Great Song Pod. Follow J.R. Richards. He's going to talk a little bit about what he's doing now, where you can hear him, and the things that he's got going on in his post-Dishwalla life. And so make sure you check out everything that he's got. And support him, and so that he can continue to make great music. But without further ado, we are obviously super excited to bring you an interview with the writer of this song, original lead singer of Dishwalla, J.R. Richards. Let's get to it.
Podcast.
All right, ladies and gents, we are here with J.R. Richards, lead singer and songwriter of Counting Blue Cars by Dishwalla. J.R., thanks so much for joining us today, man. We really appreciate your time.
Hey, man, it's an honor to be here. Thanks for having me.
Outstanding. I just told you a moment ago, but we're so hyped to cover this song. We're so hyped to get to talk to you. So, like, the era of this song was like my teenage, you know, 15, 16 year old era. So, like, they say that's the music that you always sort of return to and cherish. And I definitely find that to be true about this song. I will never skip the song, even on, you know what I mean? If I was at church and this song came on, I think I would just let it play on through. It doesn't matter. I'm just, so, you know, this is a big deal for us, man. This is a real, real heavy hitter for us. So I'll just start. I want to ask you a question. First, I just want to get your perspective on this. Counting Blue Cars has its share of time on the charts, of course. The real testament to me of its like mega hit status was that you guys won the ASCAP award 2 years in a row for the song that gets most radio airplay. I'd love to hear your thoughts on kind of how it feels to write something that all of a sudden you're hearing everywhere and people are singing all over the world for the next, you know, 20 years later, people will still sing this song, you know, word for word, whenever it comes on and whenever they hear it. What's that feeling like to have a song that blows up that way?
Well, I mean, that's a good question. It's very surreal because it was, you know, really the first single that we really pushed. So, I mean, I think at the time it felt like, gosh, this is really easy. You know, you put a song out and they played a gazillion times, but you know, it's one of those things where the planets were basically in alignment, and for whatever reason, the song just kept getting played. What radio stations would say that the song doesn't have any burn, that basically people just don't get burned out listening to it over and over again, which I was surprised to hear. But that's
the highest of all compliments.
Yeah. Well, it is, you know, and it's amazing, which is why it ended up being the NASCAP award winner for that reason, because people would play it so much. Because, you know, radio stations, especially in the 90s, were really conscious of the fact that they didn't want to bum their audience out by overplaying certain things, especially in alternative music. So they were very conscious of that. But for some reason, they would do their little call-out research thing, and people would say, no, I love the song. I'm you know, keep playing it. So there you have it.
That's cool. You know, there's an element of positivity to it that was not quite as prevalent maybe in rock music at that point. You know, there was a lot of rock music that was, you know, you're starting to get into like the new metal era. And, you know, so a lot of it was kind of depressing. I always find that songs that kind of shine a light a little bit, maybe get some extra love from the listeners. I don't know if you feel the same way or kind of have that same thought, but, you know, maybe that played into a little bit. I don't know.
I definitely agree. I mean, for me as a listener, not just as a songwriter, I've always been latched onto songs that even if they were a bit melancholy or had some dark reason for being written, if there was something positive or uplifting in there that you could grasp onto, you know, some light that was in the music, then that's what really hooked me. And I think people do appreciate that. It's like, you know, we want, you know, it's kind of like when you go and you see Game of Thrones, for example, and it ends and it's not the fairy tale ending necessarily, you know, where everybody's okay. And I think that sometimes in music, you want to hear that as well, wherever, you know, that things land in an okay position. So even when I would write a song about, you know, something dark or heavy situation or something, you know, something bad that inspired it, I always try to end or have in the song at least somewhere there's some uplifting moment in there, and perhaps that's what, you know, kept that song, gave it kind of its classic status where people go back and listen to it still.
So which side of the Game of Thrones ending do you fall? Are you on the critics that are like, oh, that was the worst ending ever, or do you get it being are you a Game of Thrones fan?
Yeah, I mean, I am, you know, and I don't get a chance to watch it like on a regular basis, so I usually have to binge it every once in a while when I get a window to do that. But you know, which is actually different. I think it's interesting when you watch one of those things and you watch it from start to finish without you know, a week break or you know, whatever it can be for some people. When you watch it all at one time, I think it in some ways it feels completely different. You haven't had a chance to like zone out on it for a week and go, well, what about this or what about that? So for me, I saw it all in one shot and I was, you know, I enjoyed it. So I really can't say it was bad. I enjoyed it. So I was all good.
We feel the same here on the show about albums. We feel like listening to albums is a really lost art. And for us, we're still like kind of hardcore album guys. You know, I want something that I can listen to from start to finish that gives me an experience, got highs and lows and hills and valleys and all the things, you know. Yeah. I feel like we miss out on that a little bit when we just, you know, when we just pick and choose. And, you know, it's almost a time where like streaming and iTunes and shuffle play rules to the degree that it's, you know, it's almost not even you know, album listening just isn't a thing anymore. You know, how do you feel about something like that? Do you find that to be true in your case, or you know, how do you feel about that personally?
Yeah, I mean, it's weird how that's changed. You know, but the fact that you can, you know, pick a song off of an album, not have to, you know, if you liked a song on an album back in the day in the 90s, for example, if you liked Counting Blue Cars, I guess you could find that as a single, but generally you'd have to go buy the whole album if you wanted one or two songs. Now you can just pick those songs. Or you buy the album and you can play it in any order you want. And I know for me, I still am old school when I you know, I'll record a whole album and I'll have a, you know, a sequence that's from start to finish that for me tells the story and the way I hear it. So it would, you know, be nice if people still listen to it that way, but you're right. You know, typically so many people don't anymore. They might listen to just a few songs, or a totally random shuffled order. You know, yeah. So it's a different experience.
I can't even take the idea of listening to an album, maybe a greatest hits album, but listening to an album on shuffle for me is, I can't, it's not, it belongs, you know, I feel like these people worked really hard on this sequence and all this stuff. I can't do
They probably debated what song went in what spot and everything.
Man.
Oh yeah. Yeah. You kick that around big time, you know, to feel what, you know, different keys, different tempos, you know, different moods. You know, how does it tell a story from beginning to end?
Yeah. Okay, so I read that some people were so upset at the notion of referring to God as female in Counting Blue Cars that you actually received death threats. Like, people got so mad that they wrote letters down on actual paper and they paid for a stamp to send you death threats?
Oh yes. Yeah. So we had people picketing in places, you know. But it was, I had to change. Yeah, it was crazy. I had to change my phone number a few times, and I didn't really think that much about it. I didn't feel like what I was using a female pronoun. I didn't think was anything groundbreaking by any means. But right. It definitely upset some people. I mean, I remember one night coming home, and there was, you know, when I actually, you know, you had a message machine, and I hit play on it, and this guy just goes, "Boy, you dead. Watch your back."
Oh my God. What in the world?
That was it. I was like, whoa. That was the creepiest one. Goodness. This guy sounded completely for real, like he was going to totally...
Like he was going to do it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
But, you know, so I had my share of those. But, you know, that in other ways, I think that, you know, it wasn't on purpose, but because it did have some controversy and made people think and polarize people one way or the other, that typically does mean a song is doing something. And I think it's important to, you know, and it certainly helps in how well the songs can succeed sometimes just from that lyrical content sparking something, some response.
Well, I think you made a strategic, wise play by producing something for Amy Grant, opposite that, being the conservative that she is on Big Yellow Taxi. That was, was well played on that end. How was it working with Amy Grant? I'm a huge Amy Grant fan, believe it or not.
Oh,
I
know that's weird. She's fantastic. Well, we were on the same label, and we had the same A&R person, so... it was, I think that really the idea was that she, you know, she just had a massive, massive album. It was such a great album. And so she was doing her follow-up. And sometimes I think labels can kind of overthink things. You know, they want that success so bad to repeat itself that they were, I think, overthinking a lot of what she had done. So she had she'd covered Big Yellow Taxi. And the version she did was, I think, was maybe a little... how would they categorize it? I guess it would have been, you know, like adult contemporary. So they thought, well, maybe we should be appealing more to younger folks. So let's get a younger producer in to go and redo the song in a way they would do it with her singing on it. So, you know, I ended up using the guys from Dishwalla, went in and replayed everything. I even sang backups on it and basically completely redid the song for radio.
Dishwalla featuring Amy Grant.
Yeah. I mean, that's really what it ended up being. You know, and it has a really cool vibe to it. And I think they went and pushed that towards, you know, some different radio stations in hopes of getting, you know, some different style radio airplay for her song in order for it to be more, you know, more successful. Whether that happened, I don't know. I know we did a really cool version of the song for her, and she's got a great voice, and, you know, she killed it either way. So it's good.
That's great. I do have a question about, so my understanding is that Dishwalla went on kind of a hiatus in 2005, and then when they reformed, you said you guys go ahead, right? And then Justin Fox joined them on lead vocals, and that's kind of how they are traveling now. My question is, how does it feel to be the David Lee Roth of Dishwalla? What's that like as far as being the, you know, there's always that people gravitate to the first guy, you know what I mean? So I'm sure there are people out there who are like, that's not my Dishwalla, you know what I'm saying? How does it feel to be the David Lee Roth of Dishwalla?
Well, I'd rather be David Lee Roth than Sammy Hagar. No offense to Sammy.
Oh, shots fired. Shots fired.
Me and Rob debate that all the time. He's more partial to Roth, and I'm more partial to Hagar, so there we go.
Well, they both did great stuff, so be fair to him. But it is a bit odd when you know, changing a singer in a band is a much bigger deal than changing a drummer or a bass player, you know. So it's a harder position to cover because it's such a personal instrument, being a voice. And, you know, nothing to do with me personally or Justin even, and he's a great singer, so it's all good. But yeah, I think it's tough on fans. And but we've had, you know, the band has had its share of personnel changes, you know, probably more than people realize. I think people recognize when the vocals change, everybody generally gets that one. But, you know, we had different bass players, different drummers, different keyboard players. So there was a lot of changing going on in Dishwalla's history. It's just that people really recognize the one voice change, I think, more than anything, and probably just that.
Sure.
You know?
Yeah. I'm curious, who are your influences? This is kind of a two-part question. So I'd like to know a little bit about who are your influences as a writer and a singer. And then after that, I have a follow-up that's connected. But let's start there. Who are your influences as a writer, and who are your influences as a vocalist?
Good question. I mean, you know, I love the you know, the old kind of the old school singer songwriter guys, and you know, I grew up listening to a lot of bands that were a bit mellower, maybe, you know, and so much of it from my parents, I guess. You know, I mean, initially, like, of course, the Beatles and things like that were, you know, some of the first rock bands were writing their own songs, right, as opposed to, you know, covering somebody else's tune. I love vocal groups like Simon Garfunkel and Cat Stevens and stuff like that. So, but then on the other end of the spectrum, in terms of singers, I was like singers, big, powerful voices. So, you know, I was partial more towards, you know, Bono or Freddie Mercury, you know, those kind of big, powerful, you know, wailing voices. And then from the song perspective too, just kind of songs that, again, like we were talking about earlier, songs that had some hope in them. You know, I for whatever reason, that was so much more powerful to me when there was, you know, hopeful message in there, however disguised it might be, and inspiring in that way. You know, I think that kind of stuff just hits me in the core.
Awesome.
Follow
up to that. Who do you think that you have been an influence on? What do you think the imprint of not only this song, but Dishwalla's work and your work as a solo artist afterward, what do you think your imprint is on kind of rock and pop music from, you know, people who were my age when that song came out, you know, will always look to Counting Blue Cars as kind of a landmark song. You know, do you hear or kind of see your influence anywhere in rock and pop music now or since then?
Well, I mean, that's a good question. I think we definitely influenced a lot of the industry in that moment, and because we were one of the first bands that, you know, wasn't doing this, you know, new metal thing or this punk rock thing or this grunge thing, because we were, you know, what they called post-grunge. So, and instead we're writing things that were, you know, more about melody and maybe a little more lighthearted, or, you know, or had some interesting positive kind of story kind of things. I think that we kind of opened the door for a lot of bands, you know, like Tonic or Vertical Horizon or whatever, to kind of come out and even take it a step further. So, you know, I don't know if that's the case, but it seemed to me that kind of made it okay. Because I know when we initially were trying to get ourselves played on the radio, our label was like, guys, dude, where the heck is this music going to go? You know, you don't fit anywhere.
Where do you put it?
You know, exactly. You know, you're not grunge and you're not punk and you're not metal. I mean, what are we supposed to do with you? So that was an issue, but it ended up being a positive thing for us, because we ended up, when we did put us on the radio, people were like, whoa, that it stood out. So people would call in and say, hey, let me hear it again.
I was even thinking, listening to the song kind of from an analysis and analytic perspective in doing research, you know, I was listening to even the chords on the chorus were in the key of D major. That E major chord in the chorus is not something that's really happening in rock music at that point. You know, that two major chord is very, it's much more sort of, and I you know, the word Beatlesque gets overused, but since you brought them up already, I'm going to go ahead and go there. You know, that right. with the background harmonies, you know, in there is really something that was not being heard a lot in like rock music at that point. So I totally get what you mean. It was kind of it was a different vibe. It had a smile on its face. You know what I'm saying? It was just nice and pleasant. We had all the grunge and stuff for a good while that had reigned for several years on radio and on MTV and everything. And then, and then all of a sudden Counting Blue Cars comes through and it's got a kind of a childlike wonder, you know, it's got this conversations with the child, and it's just a little, it was just kind of some sunshine. I think that was nice.
But it still had intensity too. That first chord at the beginning is like right in your face.
I love it.
And so thick. So it's not like necessarily bubblegum happiness.
Right.
But it's enough. It's enough joy and hope, as you said, with still some guts behind it. So,
absolutely.
So very well done on that.
No. Oh, well, thank you. Well, you know, you're right. I think it's just that I love contrast. So, you know, the verses are all minor, and it starts with that B minor, and it, you know, kind of rolls down and into a G major 7, you know, which is an unusual chord for rock. So, too, in the way that we were playing it. But it's a little, you know, a little darker, which kind of fit a little more with the time. But you're right. When you hit that chorus, it's all of a sudden this big D major to E major, G major. It's this big up, happy kind of thing that it hits, but with big guitars and stuff. And so I think that you're right, absolutely right. That completely took people by surprise, because that's not what you were hearing typically on the radio.
All right, JR, got a little bit of a curveball that I ask everyone. So get ready. We ask everybody that we interview, okay, and everybody always has a little bit different answer. So you're on tour or you're on the road and you go into a gas station. What is your snack food of choice? Do you get a candy bar, bag of chips? If so, what's your favorite? What do you pick? When you're on tour with me and Rob, what do you pick when you go into the gas station? When we're your backing band, what do we grab for you in the gas station?
Okay, all right. So it kind of depends where I'm at in the country, because there's different things available around, you know, and if I'm in a different country too, you know, God knows.
You can Americanize it, or you can do whatever you want. You can do it over there.
I'll Americanize it. I'm American, so I will Americanize it. I think typically what I go for is a double shot espresso from Starbucks. All right. And a Tiger's milk bar. Are you guys familiar with those?
Oh, that's a different one.
I'm totally unfamiliar with
this.
We've
been introduced to different snack foods from the people we've talked to, so this is a new one for us. Okay. Tiger's milk bar? Right.
Tiger's milk bar, the honey one, is the bomb, is epic.
I'm writing this down.
We're going to try and find one in Nashville.
That's our goal now. After we get off here, is going to be to find a Tiger's milk bar honey here in Nashville.
So yeah, and you got to wash it down with the Starbucks double shot espresso.
All right. Duly noted. Duly noted.
Okay.
Outstanding. All right. You've been so generous with your time, and we're grateful for that. I got a couple more questions, if that's okay.
Yeah,
we'll just rapid fire you with a couple of more, and then we'll let you be on your way. What was the final tally on Blue Cars? How many were there?
You know, that's a good question. We're still counting.
Still to this day.
Still counting.
Still
to this day.
Outstanding. I, you know, we talked a little bit about kind of the, I didn't give you the, you know, tell us how this song came about. You know, I try to avoid that question. But if you would just give us just kind of a little bit, I've read, some things about you kind of having a conversation with, you know, what is maybe like an inner child, or just trying to having a conversation with yourself that leads to these questions and this sort of, you know, this innocent conversation about God and life. And, you know, give us just a little bit deeper, maybe insight into where you were kind of when you came up with this idea.
Sure. Yeah. I think that at that time, that song, I was early 20s, I guess, at this point when I wrote it. So, still pretty young myself, but I think that I was very aware of the fact that when you're a child, we haven't put any limits on ourselves. You know, nobody's there telling you that this is how something is, and there's no reason to question anything else. And there's a beauty in, you know, how children see things, because they are ready to accept anything. So sometimes they see things maybe clearer than we do. So that was kind of the idea behind the song, the inspiration that got me going. And then when I started writing about it, it just kind of became this journey that a child was having. And then it became a little more of a spiritual journey that he was having. Which is, you know, to like the idea that we always, whenever we refer to God, it's always with a male pronoun. And, you know, God is supposed to be this omnipotent being that is, you know, neither male nor female. And hopefully, you know, certainly both, and everything else you can think of, I would imagine. So why not a child seeing it from a female perspective? And then, you know, and then that was it. It wasn't, you know, I didn't go much deeper than that. I really didn't think about it too much. It's just try to crafting this journey and create, you know, some good imagery and things like that as, you know, whatever, looking for answers. And I put the song to bed, and it was interesting that I never thought of it as being single or anything. And I ended up, the label ended up gravitating towards it, and It ends up blowing into this massive hit, but you know, I wish I had a deeper story, but that's really, you know, all that kind of went through my head as I was writing it, and then it was on to the next song.
That's cool. That's great. What if you could tell us, and I'm sure there are plenty of these, but if you could tell us one other question that you would like to ask God, what's one other question you would like to ask God?
Why the chicken tacos in the UK are not very good.
There we go.
Wow. Yeah.
Why they don't have Tiger's Milk Bar Honey over there, right?
No, they don't, sadly. So, you know. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Bad chicken tacos are definitely a matter of prayer. It's for sure.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Well, they're my favorite thing on the planet, so it's hard to get good Mexican food in the UK, sadly.
Well, my wife is Mexican. Come on over and we'll have some chicken tacos. Yeah, we so we'll see you the next time you're back in Nashville. Come on over and we'll show you how it's done.
I will take you up on that in a heartbeat. So you watch yourself.
We'll even have a Tiger's Milk Bar Honey waiting for you. I don't know if you. We didn't give it a chance. Are you still heavily invested or involved in the 20K Watts project? I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about that. That looked I don't know a whole lot about it, just what I've seen online, but it seems like a pretty cool little deal. Would you want to? Are you still doing that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm still a part of it, and it's still, you know, an entity. It's so much of it's been handed over to other younger people to take on, but I started it with my manager, Leo Rossi, and his son Ryan, who was also a bandmate of mine. He actually played guitar for me, starting for my first solo album. So, we started by going down to Central America, and we were taking down solar energy and introducing it to a lot of the very rural areas where they had no electricity. So, you know, not having electricity obviously creates a lot of problems, especially in a really hot climate. So, you know, it was a lot of time spent on roofs of little shacks, you know, setting up solar panels and trying to create refrigeration for some of the little health shacks that they would have, you know, just so that they could have, you know, a type 1 diabetic child could have insulin and didn't have to travel, you know, 8 hours to go get insulin and walking, and they weren't having to burn kerosene light inside their houses in order to see at night while the kids were studying, and all the children had respiratory problems because they were, you know, used this really poor, cheap kerosene to create light at night. So it was just, that's really what we were doing. It was just a lot of time spent going down there, raising money in the States, and then buying things to help, and then bringing down there and trying to teach people how to use them and introducing them to this technology.
Well, good on you for that. As much as we love your contribution to counting blue cars, that's going a step further. That's another true. Level of win. Yeah. So well done on that. So props to you on that, JR.
You. Yeah. Again,
thank you so much again for your time and for everything that you've set aside for us. We really appreciate it. Yeah. Thank you.
Do you have anything else going on that you want people to know about? What's happening with JR right now that people can go, where can they find you? How can they get to your stuff, and where can they catch you?
Well, you can find me just about anywhere. I just finished a partial US tour. I did not get to where you guys are at. Unfortunately, I'm hoping to come back around to Nashville perhaps towards the end of this year. I was down in South America for a while, and I'm looking at going into Asia for a bit and then back to the States. So I've been busy doing that because I haven't been touring that much past few years, but I've been doing a lot this year, and I'm working on my 10th album, my fifth solo album. Yeah. So, I just released an album called Under the Cover. That is, an album of all covers. Just songs, cover songs that I've enjoyed growing up, and just kind of did my take on all of them and just put that out a few months back. And, you can find me on Facebook, JR Richards. You can find me at JRRichardsMusic.com. I'm super, super active, and, I hope to be playing music and not having a real job as long as I can.
Yeah. Here's to that.
Yeah.
Right.
So, but thanks again, man. We really, really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Oh gosh. You guys, my absolute pleasure. Thanks so much for having me on the show. That's just awesome. And please, you know, down the line, don't hesitate to reach out at any time. Okay.
Outstanding. Thanks so much, man. Have a good rest of the evening.
Take care on that. All see right. you, JR.
All right. Cheers, you guys. Thank you.
Podcast.
So there we have it, ladies and gents.
Man, that was fun.
Dude, I can't believe we get to do this.
This is great.
We're just schlubs, you know what I mean, that lucked into this.
I'm in an Ivan Drago t-shirt,
yeah,
for goodness sake.
Exactly.
Sakes.
Yeah, I'm in a Hard Rock Cafe shirt.
Yeah, we're just sitting here at a table in my kitchen.
Getting to do awesome stuff, and I can't believe it. By the way, take that, Bono.
That's right.
I mean, keep doing what you're doing, but how about JR out here changing the world?
That's awesome.
That's incredible. Man, again, I know we really geeked pretty hard on this episode. So if this is your first time listening, we normally get excited. We don't normally get this excited. You know what I'm saying? There's just something about this song that brought out a level of fanboy in us. You know what I mean? That is atypical to some degree. I mean, we're always doofuses.
We have our moments.
But I feel like this episode, we just went kind of extra hard on the you know.
And if you are just finding us for the first time because of JR and because of Dishwalla, go back and check out some of our older stuff. Listen to our back catalog. See if you find something in there that you like.
Yeah, greatsongpodcast.com is always open for
That's
you.
Right. Open
always,
for business.
It's a beautiful thing about the internet.
Man, we're in season four.
We are really in season four.
That's
I can't
crazy.
Believe
We've been
it.
Doing this for a while.
This is so much fun, dude. Like, thanks everybody for listening, but really, JP, come on. Thanks, man.
Dude, thank this you, buddy. Dude. Thanks for the countries around the world, those that we know how to pronounce,
come
right?
On.
And those that we don't, for listening and supporting us.
I mean, Nepal?
Come on.
We have listeners in Nepal.
And we chart out there.
Let's do this.
That's right.
Let's do this.
World tour. Here
world
we go.
World tour. Here we go. We'll be coming
we're
soon.
We're coming to a city near you.
To a village near you.
That's right. Village near
you. And we're bringing solar panels.
We are. That's
come
right.
Come on.
We're going to change the world.
Yeah. All right. Man, I can't wait to see you guys next week. We got more great songs coming at you in season four. But until then, I'm Rob.
I am JP.
Go listen to some music.